What's up, guys? Frank here with my dude, Manuel Gagenux of Zeal and Ardor, who has a powerful new record out, August 23rd, titled Greif. Dude, it's been, it's weird because it feels like it's been years, but I think it's only been like 10 months since I've seen you. How the hell you been?
I've been good. I've been recording this record, obviously. It's funny because we always bump into each other saying like, it's been a while. So I think we've gone on like a series on it's been a while encounters that it just accumulates to it being a while.
It's actually quite funny because it's like my mind, maybe as I get older, I just think that like things are a lot longer than they actually are. You know what I mean? Like I said, like 10 months feels like years, but it's, I guess that has been a while, but still in the grand, thought of things, it's really not at all.
Well, yeah, but it's also due to you traveling a lot. And I think with that comes so many experiences that it just feels like it's just denser, I guess.
Right. Yeah, I mean that goes for you too. You guys have been like really working so hard, through the years. I mean, like if you think about like 8 years of your life has just been devoted to Zeal and Ardor and every aspect of it, including writing, recording, touring, and everything, and it adds up,
Yeah, what a waste.
So Greif, let's talk about this. I mean, immediately it's a stark album title, and from what I understand, it's based on an annual tradition found in Switzerland. And I apologize. I'm not Swiss and don't know the culture really, so or the traditions. But I think from what I understand, it's a parade in your hometown that includes a mythical creature that stands for the working class against the rich. Is that sort of right?
It's like this 800-year-old tradition where this guy in a Greif costume, griffin costume, just presents his backside essentially to the rich part of town. And like when you're a kid, you would go there with your school class and see this. It's like, oh, cool, funny costumes, but then you're like, well, this is class war. And you get to like experience it as a kid. And I think that was kind of cool enough to put it at as an album cover.
Is like one of the richer countries of the world. So it's funny that like a notion like that would come from Switzerland,
I mean that being said, it is a very old tradition. So Switzerland has been known or has been rich like in it's been 100 years, something like that. So prior to that, it's just farmers and people afraid of the Roman Empire.
Right. Okay. All right.
So
Yeah,
that's
that
where when that came from.
makes total sense. And I believe that was so am I actually saying the name of the album wrong? It's Greif, not Grief.
Yeah, it's Greif, but I mean I knew that the grief connotation is there, and I leaned into it anyway, so
Yeah.
everything is valid.
Well, that's why I guess that it kind of has like almost maybe some sort of double connotation to it, considering that this is based off of, the tradition, that's for the working people against the rich class and everything. Is this record more of like a social commentary to something like politics or the state of big corporations?
It is less that than the other records were. This is far more personal, I'd say. Also, with this having like a link to my childhood essentially, and the childhood of everyone playing on the record, it's just I think the scope is way smaller. Whereas with old records, I would make a conscious effort not to say I or me, but just us and them. And this is a very much me and you record.
I love that. I mean, a lot has changed, obviously. By the way, the record is fucking fantastic.
Oh, glad you like it.
Oh, dude, I fell in love with it like on first listen, and I've already heard it. I mean, I just opened it up like 2 days ago, and I think I've already listened to it like six times,
Oh,
and
shit.
it. I feel like as a Zeal and Ardor fan that's been listening to you guys over the years, or listening to you over the years, it's a bit shocking. I mean, on the last record cycle, we spoke about at length about how, you've been the primary everything for the band. You spending morning through night working out, every detail of every song, and then basically giving like a finished product to the rest of your guys. And on Greif, you completely flipped that script and worked, with your whole band. Firstly, I wanted to know what was the catalyst that brought that change to you, for you, in you.
I still write everything myself, but the thing is, when I think of Zeal Ardor at its best, it's us performing live. And that is in a great part due to the people on stage and my friends who, you know, helped me do this music. And it's kind of a no-brainer to have them on the record as well. And that was that. So it wasn't really like a big change. It was just like a more of a, why haven't I thought of this earlier?
I mean, you're not wrong. it's mm-hmm. I mean, you have been working with these guys for quite a while, so it's, you know, I think like such a pleasant, amazing change too. You know, I mean, so you mentioned that you still wrote everything for this album, mm-hmm. but you basically incorporated them into what you were doing in the studio and recording, I'm assuming. Do you feel that, and you know, I've been watching you guys for years, and do you feel like these elements, you know, for like, there's so many new things going on this record, so many new feels, so many new sounds and everything. Do you feel that that's simply by having the, you know, six layers recorded, or was there something else to the mix and what you were doing that, you know, made this the final outcome?
I mean, that's a part of it, but it is, I mean, there's far more, I call it colors or whatever. There's like the palette has been extended a little bit. And I mean, it would have been easy for us to make like another heavier record and just be like that band forever. And I feel that is enticing, but that's not who we are. And it just kind of feels more honest and more true to us to have weird other elements in it. And that is also, yeah, because the way they play and the tones they choose for this record.
Right. Yeah. And you did mention, I mean, like how it's really been like a solo act, and has that really drawn any kind of weird, awkward times? Like the fact that you're doing everything and then like you have this band that's been around for, you know, whatever, 6 to 8 years now.
I mean, there was a bit of a point where the guys were kind of, you know, frustrated, and we're in a process of democratizing everything in the band. So it used to be like, I come with a couple of tour dates and just like, this is it, take it or leave it. And I mean, you know, there's people in the band that have kids, and that's not really super cool. So now everyone's at the table from minute one, and it just feels way, way more friendly. And I'm really glad we did it.
Yeah, I am too. I mean, you know, the result's amazing. It sounds so full. It breathes new, like another dimension into an already awesome band that you established. You know, did this actually turn out the way that you thought it would, or did it kind of exceed your expectations?
It exceeded it. But I mean, I knew that I didn't know the end result. And I think that was the really intriguing part about it. And I'm very happy with how it came out. And I'm proud of my people. We did it.
That's cool. Was there any like surprises along the way?
Tons of micro surprises, just like, you know, shit. Like I essentially gave them a demo and like every line that they should play. And, you know, like it was small things like coming to the conclusion that I'm probably not the best player, bass player in my band. And just the way certain vocal things are delivered that I wouldn't have thought of. It's just more thought has been put into this than I could have had put into it by myself.
That, I mean, that makes a lot of sense, you know. And that said, did you have to kind of take the writing from a different standpoint? Because now you're not writing for the performance of you, but like the performance of somebody else.
I mean, I sort of kind of did that earlier too. There's a song called Trust No One, which has like a, I want to say doomy or a very, very stoner rocky like breakdown thing. That's just because I know that Mark, large singer guy, loves that sort of thing. And I was like, he's gonna fucking love this. So there's a lot more of that, just kind of catering to their strengths and to what they like with this record. And I think it's just like this fun little bouquet. Well, it's not only fun, but also a fun bouquet of songs.
Right. It is. I mean, like the, you know, aside from how it sounds and all the, as you put it, colors and, you know, elements that went into it, I think, you know, it as a standalone, as just like a written concept, it's such a beautiful thing, because I hate to do the cliche thing, but like you have some of your heaviest and lightest songs in the same record on this one, you know? And could we explore like what was that writing? You know, like was just the time that you felt like this duality in your life or something? Like, how did that come about?
Well, yeah, but also like I was writing music for a movie that has like a fictitious metal band, and I did all the metal songs for that, and then it came to time to write this album, and I mean, to a certain degree, I was kind of metaled out, and maybe that was a factor in how this is kind of played out, because even prior to this, I try to explore funny or interesting elements within the metal realm. And in this particular case, I kind of went to an extreme with that, where I think I was, yeah, searching for something new. And I scoured every corner of music for that. Well, not every corner, but a lot of avenues. And yeah, I think that's because I was very much confronted with the traditional part of it and kind of tuckered out at that point.
So was there any like inspirations that you note that kind of went into this?
Yeah, I mean there's bands that are kind of not, I don't want to say stolen from, but heavily oded to on this record. There's a lot of Queens of the Stone Age on that on it. There's also Tomahawk, that Mike Patton outfit. Those are the two main ones I can think of, but also like Dutch hardcore music. Like the stupid rave music that I don't know why, but my brain gets happy when I listen to it.
Yeah,
So I miss
we'll go back to that for sure, but
the
you know, I this album, like I keep saying it, it does sound amazing. I mean, other than the writing and the elements and everything, the sound is, I think, one of the first things that you, I mean, of course, like any record, you throw it on and the first thing you hear is really the production and the quality of it all. But it has this really live, cohesive band in a room type feeling. But at the same time, so clean and big. And like, I actually thought of like Queens of the Stone Age or Foo Fighters type production was the first thing that came to mind. You know, what was that recording experience like? Because I believe that you guys did this all on your own as well, right?
Mark, the singer, built a home studio, well, a studio at his home, and we just kind of just tracked, instrument for instrument. So it wasn't like this live in the room feeling, but I think what really also gives credence to your statement is that it was mixed by Adrian Bushby, who did Foo Fighters and Spice Girls. So and
Ooh.
I think we kind of fit perfectly in the middle of that spectrum.
Yeah.
We're the Spice Fighters.
Oh,
Sounds like a Dune thing, but
I
yeah.
love that actually. I could see you be like knowing you guys, I could see you guys being really stoked that the Spice Girls are somewhere in the mix, you
Oh, absolutely.
know.
Yeah.
But that's amazing. I mean, so you guys worked in a familiar family type outfit.
We did the last three records there, so we're very much familiar with it. But I think it being not like a studio we pay like $20,000 a minute to be in, and we're all stressed out because this producer guy is here, and
Yeah. And time
there's
is
no
money
level,
and yeah.
yeah, and there's no level of intimidation with it. And so I think that gave us like the mindset of we can play a little bit and we can try shit out and have fun. And that is actually immensely important to me when recording.
For sure. I mean, that said, did you like start out with a plan? Was there one song in particular or anything that like started out one way and then ended up a completely different type of thing?
I mean, not black and white, but I think every song took a little bit of a journey. This sounds so cheesy, but yeah, every song kind of transformed in a way that I didn't expect it to. Because yeah, there's like one step of the process more now when everyone comes in and does, adds their spice to it. I knew that I didn't know how it was gonna sound in the end. And that actually isn't, that's a net positive for me, because there's like this level of excitement to it suddenly.
And you know, I mean, I've been watching you and your whole band kill it for years, and I've even become friendly with several of them. And you know, they're great dudes. I always kind of saw you guys as a family unit, you know, and it's very cute to watch. And do you feel that you know, when you think back, like really at the start of the band, like 8 years ago, that you would make it this far into your career together?
Not this far, but that we would make it together, yeah. Because like even from the first time we played, we got these gigs that were huge, you know, and we kind of trauma bonded over like not knowing what we're doing. And we kind of keep that bond alive because we've achieved so much together, and we wouldn't be here without each other. And to like replace anything would is just an unspeakable proposition to me. It doesn't make sense. Like Zeal and Ardor isn't just Manuel Gagne, it's these six people.
Right.
So yeah.
That's, I mean, again, this it's a beautiful thing. I'm really glad that you did this and you know, kind of started incorporating everybody into what you do. You know, but let's talk about your relationship with the band. I remember in our first interview, you mentioned that your live band were made up of your friends. You know, have you created music with these guys before? Have you known them through music? Did you grow up with them? What's kind of the story behind each of these members?
Well, Basel, my hometown, isn't huge. So if you do any kind of heavy music, you're bound to bump into the same people. So we never were in bands together. I think Tiziano, our guitar player, and Marco, our drummer, they were in a band called A Threnody of Worlds to Come, and they made hardcore music with shorts and high socks, if that makes any sense to you.
I can hear it,
And yeah, they were very familiar with each other. Other than that, I just kind of picked people from like kind of different disciplines. Dennis, for instance, another singer, is he's like a theater kid more. He does like a more, I would say, pop or folk music. Mark is just a stoner rock guy. And yeah, then you have the two hardcore kids. And well, Luki and Mia are both kind of in the stoner rock thing too. Stoner rock and doom psych. So I just kind of forced them to be friends through this pop project. There's so many scenarios in which it couldn't have worked out. So I'm really f happy that I'm in this universe where everything kind of worked out. And yeah.
When you put friends from kind of different backgrounds and different places in the same place, you can't ever really tell like how if they're going to hit it off or not. And, but like I said, I think I've witnessed, you know, the family-ness, you know, of what you guys do. And I've been very fortunate to watch you guys live a lot over the years and experience that silly, playful family nature dance party behind the scenes, you know, before you guys hit the stage. That's always like a really fun thing to watch, like the Zeal and Ardor DJ party zone that happens, you know, the 10 minutes before you get on stage. You know, and I feel like I have a I've been fortunate to see kind of peek behind the curtain and see that. When and where did that come from?
Well, I think we all just knew that we had to get on a high level of energy before we actually get on the stage to have an intense show. And the way I do that is just I play loud, silly dance music, and I scream at people in the lyrics until they scream back at me. And then, you know, we are all on the Venga bus at some point, and it kind of works out. That energy translates into metal surprisingly well.
Right.
Yeah, it's funny because like we're not like club people. Like we would never actually go to a rave. Like, oh, after the show we can no. Let's I just have a burger and some sleep or something. We'll drink sometimes, but it's not like you know we're like in the rave scene. But we take that micro rave and we use it for that.
I
It's a
love it.
funny, silly thing. I love it.
I love it too. It like I can see how it hypes you up. You know, I've seen again, I've been fortunate to see, you know, several bands do their thing before they get on stage. You know, some like sit in complete silence and just feel the power of Satan or whatever you want to call it, you know, like, and then there's you know, like you guys who have such serious, commanding music on stage and then really are the opposite backstage, you know, before you go on. It's kind of like this really awesome thing to see. Yeah, I just wonder, like, and I could see why, like, dance music and being silly would hype you up to go out and do it. You know, you do got to kind of command an audience for an hour or so. So it makes sense.
Yeah, get all the silly willies out. That's to make a really cool statement. Right. Yeah, we're all about getting out the silly willies prior to hitting the stage and fucking rocking out. Yeah, that's what
we do. You know, I did want to talk about. I know that this Zeal and Ardor is your life. You know, you have, if it wasn't before 8 years ago, it is now. Like, you have really honed in and made your life every aspect of this band. Like I said, and it's because it's a full-time job, you know, doing the writing and recording and promoting and touring and designing. And, you know, there's a lot to it. I don't think people really think of bands as a business, but it surely is. You know, the further you go in, do you feel that it's worth it?
I mean, I'd be silly not to. I get to yell at people professionally and, you know, travel around the world with my friends. This is the best job I could have asked for. And even to, of course, there's aspects like I'll give you an example. Like, for like now I'm doing like promo, so there's like 4 hour blocks in which I just talk to different outlets in like, you know, 30 minutes sections. So I was about to complain, like, oh, this is such a drag, when I just remembered that's not even 50% of like a normal work day for a normal human being. And that kind of puts everything into context. So I don't think I'm in a situation to complain, more of in a situation where I can be grateful. That's how I see it.
Right. Well, that's awesome that you can kind of keep that headspace in there and do that. And I think it's all for a good reason, because, you know, I think we're all here in 30-minute chunks to congratulate you. You know, so Manuel, congratulations on a great record. I truly love the trajectory of what you've done with the band, and I always look forward to what you're doing next. And I can't wait to see you out there, you know, and let's have a drink together, man, you know?
Hell yeah.
Sick.
Hell yeah. Thank you for your time. It's pleasant as always.
Always, always, man.